I'm the chief medical officer for U.S. Renal Care, which is the third largest dialysis company in the world. And we have facilities in 38 states, and I oversee the medical care from a corporate level delivered in those facilities. And I was responsible for the implementation and rollout of our monoclonal antibody therapy to the dialysis patients under our care, working with our physician partners. The dialysis population was uniquely adversely impacted by COVID. The bulk of our patients come into a center, interact with other patients and staff in close quarters for extended periods of time. And they transit through the community to get to their treatments, and they had to do that during COVID because if you don't get dialysis, it can end your life. Given their kidney disease, their age, or other illnesses, we knew that if they had COVID, they were at high risk for having to go to the hospital and perhaps dying. We collectively, as clinicians and as healthcare leaders, were desperate for a solution. So, searching the literature all the time for what we could do. And I remember the day that I saw the New England Journal of Medicine article about the impact of these monoclonal antibody therapies on high-risk outpatients. And dialysis facilities are uniquely positioned to be able to administer this therapy. While they were sitting there getting their blood cleaned as part of their standard treatment, we could infuse the drug and then meet the obligatory monitoring of an hour after the infusion. There's a trust built up between the staff at the dialysis unit and the patients. And we engaged their doctors. So their doctors were the ones consenting them, doctors that had cared for them a long time and managed their dialysis care. So we had good adoption of the therapy. And as the data evolved and the data kept accumulating that this was safe and effective, and the Infectious Disease Society of America and the NIH, you know, came out supportive of these medications. All those things led our patients to accept the therapy. We did a multi-pronged approach to get education and awareness out there about how to give it and what supplies that you needed to do it. So we had a ready-made package that we could get a facility prepared to deliver the medication within 24 hours. I did very directed outreach too, where we have a dashboard and we could see where we had a lot of patients impacted. And I would call the medical director at that facility and say, we have this therapy, this is how you give it, educate them, review the literature with them, and talk to them about utilizing the therapy. I didn't have a single medical director that said, no, I don't want to do that. One reason we talked about our data was because we're not in a position to be able to wait for four-year trials to be able to offer this. Because we were rolling this out org-wide, I held frequent calls just on this topic, where our doctors could call in and share their experience, ask questions, and then our nursing leadership did a similar process with the nursing staff as well. So that chatting and sharing, and I did it and it went well, and these were the things I learned, or this was how my patient responded, were really important, because this was stressful to give a completely new therapy, you know, that was under an EUA. And I think COVID made us all a little more accepting of risk, because we knew what happened if we didn't do anything. To summarize, I think we had an environment desperate for therapeutic alternatives. We had logistic capabilities that made this easier than it is in some other settings. And I think we had a physician champion. And I think we developed operational processes which made it easy to give it. And I think those were the things that allowed us to scale in ways that perhaps other healthcare settings were less able to do. COVID will likely become a bit of a chronic illness in this country, where there will be a low grade infection rate around the country. I don't think the need for these therapeutics is gonna go away.